Coming to Northeast Wisconsin live from the Civic Media Studios and featuring TV and radio broadcast veteran John Maino, along with the City of Green Bay's longest serving mayor, Jim Schmidt. This is Maino and the Mayor. Here are your hosts, John Maino and Jim Schmidt.
Thank you very much. Welcome back. Maino and the Mayor on a good-looking Friday morning. Special thanks to Bell and Sports Medicine, Mark Cusin, John Miller from NBC 26, Kevin Burkel from Burkel's One Block Over, Dennis from the Glam Band is here. And a reminder, we've got the contest going. How many passing yards for Jordan Love tonight? You win yourself an official NFL draft cap. But first, ladies and gentlemen, from the mean streets of Calumet City, Illinois, a young man who dreamed of wearing the sweater of his beloved Chicago Blackhawks to be the next Keith Magnuson, Stan Mikita, Jerry King Khan Korab, or even the legendary, the Golden Jet. But instead, growing up to 6'2", 298 pounds of solid muscle, he went to Eastern Illinois, where he was Defensive Player of the Year twice in a row. Then joins the National Football League, where he comes to Green Bay and becomes a cult hero. A legacy that lives to this day. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the one, the only, John Jurko Jurkovic.
Buenos dias, my friend. Buenos dias.
What's up, Jurko?
Man, you got so much energy in the morning. I just got the phone call. I woke up. Amanda goes, you got 4 minutes. And I went to the bathroom and I splashed water in my face. You know, it was Christmas morning yesterday because the NFL season kicked off.
Yes.
And after that exciting Kansas City victory where it looked like Baltimore was going to tie up the game, I decided to tie one on last night, and I didn't get home till after midnight. So, woo, I'm a little bit groggy, but thank you for the wonderful introduction. And who I wanted to be with the Blackhawks sweater was Ivan Boldarev.
Oh.
Ivan Boldarev. Yeah, he played for the Hawks for about three seasons, led the team in scoring in the mid-70s. He's the only guy that I knew that had Ivan as his first name.
I was going to say, which is your given name, right?
Yeah, that's my given name by my mom and dad. It just translates to John, so.
But you were a huge hockey fan.
And then Ivan Ivan DeJesus came into the league.
Oh, that's right.
He was a shortstop for the Chicago Cubs. So I was like, look at this. Two Ivans. Wow. And my guess is 278 yards tonight for Jordan Love.
Okay. Right. We're putting
Put it down.
You can win the cap.
Put it down. 278, I want a cap, I want a chapeau, and I want to start this whole thing off by thanking John Maino, because Maino got me started in radio, which has led to the problem that Chicago listeners have to listen to every single day. We're at the Altoona Supper Club in New Holstein, Wisconsin, when we kicked this whole thing off, my radio career back in its infancy. Wow. And what was it, 92 or 1991?
Two.
Yeah, 1992, my second year there.
First year.
1 hour show. We drive down. We'd entertain the masses, and I drive back on a Monday night. Back in the days when I was single and didn't have a care.
And it would be so crowded that people would have to get reservations. They actually sold like standing room tickets in the back. Remember that, Jurko, how big that grew?
Yeah, oh, it was a fun time. It was a fun time. I remember it was close to Road America. That's what I remember.
Yep, absolutely. But tell them about whatever with your favorite sport of hockey. Tell them how spectacular we were in our preparation for our hockey games.
We were terrible. was it the Green Bay Gamblers?
No, it was the Ice.
The Green Bay Ice, right, before the Green Bay Gamblers came to town. It was the Green Bay Ice. I drove up from Calumet City. And about a half hour before the contest, John goes, listen, I'm not comfortable doing play-by-play. Can you do play-by-play? I'm like, what? What? I mean, color commentary is like a walk in the park. You want to do – and I tried to do play-by-play. I swear to God, half the time I had the Blackhawks on the ice anyway. I mean, I just couldn't figure it out. And But we did that too. We had a lot of fun back in the day. And then Leroy replaced me. That Leroy Butler. Hall of Famer. He's a Hall of Famer, guys.
You know what was fun about that, Jurko? We learned, I think, six names. And one way or another, those six games made every pass during that hockey game.
Yeah. I mean, we had no choice. I mean, it was so damn quick and so damn fast.
Yeah, I have a lot of respect for guys that do that. But, Jurko, let's talk about the NFL season heading in. We're excited. Jim, for some reason, has a man crush on the Chicago Bears this year.
I don't know. I used to go to a lot of Bear games. The band that they had there was Ben Arden was the director, a friend of my dad. So I would go with the band all the time. It was called Ben's Bears. We'd sit in the end zone, and I would sit with the band. And so I watched you guys back in the day. So you would – you're not – I mean, the Packers are by far my favorite team, and then probably the Cardinals, and maybe the Lions, and then the Bears. But anyway, I do like them.
You got a big thing for Caleb Williams, their new quarterback.
Yeah, well, I would like the Bears to win a couple games. I feel bad that they've been in the cellar so long. I mean, it's 85, right?
All right. You know that George McCaskey and I were classmates at Arizona State, Jurko?
I did not know that.
Yes. We had broadcasting 301 together.
And his... nephew, his grandson Scott. You talk about Road America. So the Ostoff Resort. Have you been there, Joker?
I have not been there.
By the way, so his grandson and I know him because he owns a place there. So do we. So I think the Bears are their management is easy to like. Would you say that? Unlike some other teams,
I don't know much about them other than George, who I knew 40 years ago. But so what?
Well,
about
you know what? I tell you what they are. They're family oriented. Virginia McCaskey is still alive by the miracle of God. And George is there. There's a Brian McCaskey there. I don't know if Michael's still alive or if Michael passed away. He was the guy that started running the Bears after Papa Bear died. I think George is very likable. I don't think Virginia has ever done anything that make any enemies up in that Lake Forest area. So I think people keep her in high regard.
Right.
Brian McCaskey is one of the more intelligent McCaskeys that you're going to find out there. If there was any animosity ever, it was Michael McCaskey that people had a problem with. So otherwise, I think the family is held in high regard in the Chicagoland area.
Cool.
And because they kind of run it like a mom and pop shop, like the Rooneys. I mean, they're just not as successful as the Rooneys are. The Rooneys that have the Pittsburgh Steelers have won, I think, 5-6 Super Bowls. If the Bears have won 5-6 Super Bowls, I think everybody would be overjoyed with the McCaskey family. But because they've only got one Super Bowl title in the modern era since 66-67 when the Packers won the first two Super Bowls, I think that's a source of frustration for Chicago Bears fans.
Dennis?
Understandable, too. John, Dennis Peters here. I'm a big fan of yours. And I saw you when you got started on the radio, by the way, with John. I saw you at an express gas station in Appleton at Wisconsin and Law Street, I think it was back in the day. Now it's not even a gas station anymore. But anywho, yeah, I remember seeing you guys there. What the heck are you guys doing there in the crowded express gas station.
I don't even remember that one.
Murphy in the Morning, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Back in the
Dennis,
the
by the
season,
way, Jurko. Yeah. Dennis here is the lead singer of like the most popular band in Wisconsin and throughout the Midwest. It's called the Glam Band. And Dennis is the lead singer. He's unbelievably popular, like you can't believe. But he's also the most knowledgeable football fan I've ever met in the music industry. Oh. So he's excited to be here to talk to you.
Just one other thing on Dennis, though. Like you guys have the Hall of Fame and you got the Packer Hall of Fame. Dennis is in the Whammy Awards. And
he was vocalist of the year in the state of Wisconsin.
This is about John Jurkovic, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay. You guys are on the same level.
That's impressive.
It is.
It's impressive. Do you do any... Warren Zevon covers?
Werewolves of London, yeah. I've done that a few times.
Actually, you know what? My favorite,
Jurko
put me on to a song that I'd never heard before and is now one of my all-time favorite songs. You know what that one is, Jurko?
Is it Excitable Boy?
Nope. Lawyers, Guns, and Money.
Nice.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, Hank Williams covered that one too, boys.
Oh, did he? I didn't know that. Send Lawyers, Guns, and Money.
Yeah, that's a great tune. I went to Zevon's concerts, 14 of them, when he was alive. He was fantastic.
Jeez.
I love the guy. He spoke to me. You know how artists speak to you? Everybody's got that one artist that no matter what's going on, he's your go-to person or your go-to individual.
What was it about
Zevon was that for me.
What was it? But what was it about his music? Or was it his lyrics? Or what was it?
David Letterman called him the greatest lyricist of all time. Anybody that can sing about brucellosis and all types of different things.
Wasn't that a defensive tackle for the Packers?
You know,
in the 70s?
I remember his appearance on Letterman, his last appearance on Letterman, and Letterman asked him something, any advice or any words of wisdom? Because enjoy every sandwich. Enjoy every sandwich. Remember that?
He named his final album that. Enjoy every sandwich. Yeah, I do remember it.
Yep.
Yeah, he was fantastic. Love the guy.
I thought you would say that it was his lyrics that made him your guy, so to speak. Yeah, that would be
I mean, if you listen to Excitable Boy, I don't want to shock the audience, but if you listen to the song Excitable Boy and listen to some of the lyrics there, it's very dark.
Oh.
And it's kind of a poppy tune, you know, it's just kind of happening for you. And then all of a sudden you listen to what he's saying. It's like, sweet Jesus, this guy's sick or what?
Wow.
And he refused to play it in concert for a while because it reminded him of the times that he was, you know, doing the bad stuff, doing the drugs. And
That's why I stayed with Paul Anka. Hey,
we're talking about who doesn't love Paul Anka.
Hey, I got a text that just came in here. So where are they building the new Bears stadium?
Domed stadium, it says, yeah.
I think it's sacrilege.
They're trying to get on the lakefront.
Yeah, they got to stay down there.
The Friends of the Park and everything, Daniel Burnham's vision was not to have anything really on the lakefront. They want to tear down Soldier Field. They want to build it a little bit south of there. I don't think the city's going to allow it. I don't think there's no thirst for public funding for a stadium again.
Nor is your governor behind it.
Yeah, and Jerry Reinsdorf, of course. Jerry Reinsdorf is trying to get his own stadium there, and they've got a plot of land in the South Loop that they want to go hell. They want to go ahead and build a stadium for the White Sox there too. Yeah. The citizens do not want to fund any more stadiums for the love of God and everything holy. Yep. If anything, they should do what the Bears what the Packers have done. If you're a Bears fan and you want to see a new stadium and you want to buy some stock for $250 that isn't worth anything, you can never resell, but it's just a kind of a signification that, hey, you're a part owner of the team and you put it on the wall and you have it there proudly, then do that. Those people that want to do it, let them do it. They could pay for a new stadium. But to saddle every single individual in the state of Illinois for a new stadium, so... To answer your question, I think Arlington Park is where it's going to end up going.
Okay.
We got to set it to 1 minute break here. Can we come back? I want to discuss something that Rich Moran said on my Facebook, that if he had been your agent, you would have gotten a lot more for giving 92 to Reggie White than you got. That's going to be our discussion when we come back.
All righty.
And a little bit of gaming.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And Jim needs some help on his picks. He's so proud he gave 3 last night for the Chiefs, and he won.
I doubled my money.
So he wants to run a couple of things by you. Would that be okay?
Yeah, absolutely.
Excellent. We're with Jurko, the one and only Jurko, back in 1 minute.
W.
Hey, welcome back. It is Football Friday. We got the mayor and we got Dennis from the Glam Band. And we've got Jurko on the phone. So, Jurko, first thing I have to discuss, we had Rich Moran on our show a couple of weeks ago, and he is now a player's agent and all these things. And somebody on my Facebook said, hey, what did Jurko get from Reggie White for giving number 92? And Rich Moran said that's all you got was his blessing and dinner. And I said, I thought you got a watch. But Rich said for somebody that signed a $16 million contract, he would have held out for more. Can you set the story straight?
Well, first of all, you got to remember how it happened. So it was in the spring. There was rumors around town that they were going to get Reggie White. So I was summoned in front of the equipment room, like outside the locker room and outside the training room. I was summoned out there that the guys wanted to ask me a question. Ron Wolf wanted to ask me something. So I come walking around the corner, and it's Ron Wolf, it's Mike Holmgren, it's Sherman Lewis, Ray Rhodes, and Greg Bosch.
Oh, wow.
And they're all looking at me, and I said, hey, guys, how you doing? Good morning. You know,
like an intervention.
Yeah. Do you have your playbook?
Yeah, whatever it was.
You feel like you've been drinking a little too much.
Yeah, and so Ron goes, we're going to acquire Reggie White. We want to know if you're willing to give up your number so Reggie White can wear number 92. Now, I read the room real quick. 93, I hadn't established myself yet. If I said no, Reggie can't have my number, they'd have cut me right on the spot.
Yeah.
I'd have been gone. The Green Bay Packers waived John Jurkovic. That would have been the exact, you know, it wouldn't have been a headline. It would have been in the little small strip,
PG.
You know, during the statistics and stuff like
Transactions wire.
So yes. I go... I go, absolutely. I shook everybody's hand. Everybody was overjoyed. Everybody's happy. I go, but I do reserve the right to negotiate for the rights to the number, just so we have that established. So after everybody was happy, they're like, oh, sure. So Reggie and I talked about it. Eventually, before the holidays, Reggie got me a Rolex watch.
Okay. Oh, that's wow. Nice.
Yeah, it was a nice watch. I went to get another link in it because it was a little small for my meaty wrist. And the guy goes, hey, and little did I know, I didn't know at the time, but it was 93, I think, Reggie came in. He goes, this is an old watch. He goes, it's 14 karat gold, the band. He goes, we don't make it in 14 karat gold. You know, it was silver with the gold stripe down the middle.
Yeah.
He goes, we make them in 18 karat gold. He goes, do you want me to take the watch for you? I go, yeah. So Reggie got me a 1983 Rolex, which,
wow.
you know now that those old Rolexes, they retain their value and they actually increase in value.
Yeah, they do.
But at the time, my future wife, Brandy, was, she bought me a Movado. And I'm like, hot damn. And she goes, well, you're never going to wear my watch. And I'm like, okay, how do I handle this? So my man Joe Sims goes, hey, I'll buy that watch.
Joe Sims.
You remember Joe Sims?
I did a show with him at Kevin Burkel's bar downtown Green Bay.
Right. So Joe goes, hey, I'll buy it for $2,500. And that was about the price at the time, $3,000, $2,500. I go, that's fine. And he went and changed the bezel and the face on it. And he had it. And Reggie goes, I never called the watch a cheap watch. You can't call Rolex a cheap watch. And Reggie goes, I heard you call that watch cheap. I go, Reggie, that's not true. I go, that is not true. I said, but in the world of Rolexes, I got the Volkswagen. Reggie thought about it. And he goes, yeah, that's about right. So we had it. And then he asked me where the watch was. Well, I didn't want to tell Reggie I sold the watch to Joe Sims. So I go, I gave it to my son. It to my dad. My dad wears it proudly.
You lied to the minister.
So that
I to had minister. To. You have to lie to the minister. Sometimes a white lie is better than the cold hard truth.
Good point. Of course, what's worse, saying a lie to the minister or reading Sports Illustrated during Mass?
Oh, boy. How about having a transistor radio in during Mass listening to a Cubs game? When they're failing to get to the playoffs.
Right.
Jurko's done both.
Oh, yeah.
So Jurko, you got to help out Jim here. Jim was mayor of Green Bay for 16 years, mayor of the Super Bowl winning team.
I actually sat with you, Jurko, at one of the alumni dinners at the Green and Gold Gala.
Yeah.
You don't remember that because you were talking to everybody, but you were actually pretty entertaining at our table. So, my wife and I sat with you one year, and you signed that little helmet for us.
But now he wants you to help him make some money.
But now
today.
I got to make some. I didn't make any money off that helmet. Well, I haven't sold it. I wouldn't sell it. But hey, I like to go to the casino once in a while. So,
yeah, you like to gamble. I like that.
And he needs advice.
So I bet last night I took the Chiefs plus
minus
3, and I won, right? Because they won by six or seven. All right, six.
Yeah.
So tonight, Packers, straight up, who are you going with?
Okay, so you're going to bet the money line, or do you plan on taking, I believe, are the Packers favorite or
they're
underdogs?
Underdogs by 2.5.
Yeah, I want that number to get pushed out to 3. If that number goes to 3, then I'll take the Packers plus the 3. So we're waiting for some action to come in on the other end by Philadelphia.
That's
so
exactly
you get
right.
The number at 3. Right. Yeah, that's what you're looking to do is get that number at 3.
All right, I'm going over under.
If you're confident the Packers are going to win, you could probably get the Packers at plus 130, I guess, 125.
No, it's 130.
And if you're feeling that confident and you think the Packers are going to win outright, go ahead and just take them on the money line and make a little bit extra money.
That's not much money, though, right? I mean, you bet $100, you win $115. That's not any money.
So they're plus 115. Again, like I said, it depends how you feel.
Yeah, that's not enough money.
If you're feeling good about it, you're feeling great about the Packers, then you go ahead and make the play. My best play of the weekend is Houston, Indianapolis, right? Indianapolis is at home. It's an intra-division dog, right? The dog at home always gets the bone. But especially early season intra-division games, the home team underdog is winning at a pretty good clip. So I would take the Indianapolis Colts plus the point.
2.5.
And you could thank me on Monday.
Wow.
Right. Okay.
All right.
That's a bold move.
For $100, I'm going to win $130 on the Colts.
There you go.
There you go.
Okay.
I
okay.
like it.
Yeah. Rooting over under for tonight.
Yeah, we like over under because it kind of rooting for both teams in some way or another. The Packers, the total points is 49. Would you go over or under for that game tonight against Philly?
Okay, here's my play for you right there. I go first half under. So first if it's 49, yeah. you probably got 24 and a half or 24 for the first half.
That's a strong play.
I go first half under.
Yep. Season opener, you betcha. That's a strong play.
Teams are more conservative usually, you know, at the beginning of ball games.
Yep.
You know, it's kind of like a heavyweight boxing fight. They kind of pop each other a little bit, see what the hell is going on. I would go with first half under if you can find that number.
I got it. It's 24.
Yeah, there you go. First half under 24.
That's all right.
But okay. nothing for the whole game?
No, I mean, listen, you, if you're a good gambler, you're not making thousands of bets. You're concentrating your assets, and you're making it on plays that you know are going to be victorious.
This guy knows what he's talking
about. I told you.
This guy's
When it comes to stuff like this, Jurko's like a savant.
When we had that dinner, we talked more about, you know, the highlights of football. This is much more interesting to me. I wish I would have known this about you. This is – well, thanks. Yeah. I'm not one to split my winnings, but I will – thank you publicly.
Patty just wanted to know again how many yards you think Love will pass for because she wanted to take that for her bid. But I'm going to tell her, Patty, I'm sorry. Jurko made his bid, but he wants the cap. He wants the official.
This is not the price is right.
He picked 278.
Is that what it was?
Yep. Right.
Okay. Yep.
I got 278. Listen, if she takes 278, you guys are giving us each cap.
Okay.
Come on, we're in radio.
There's no pulling the name. Hey, there's no pulling the name out of the hat. And then all the you can't cut the hat in five. You just get five and a half.
All right, man. Jurko, we're out of time. This has been so much fun. Boy. It's incredible.
You're great.
All right, guys. Thank you.
Can we do this again sometime when you're not hungover?
Hey, got my number, Maino. Call me anytime.
Thank you, buddy. You're the best. I truly appreciate it.
Take care, John.
All right, guys.
Take care, buddy. Bye-bye. John Jurkovic. When we come back, we got some live music coming your way. Back after this. Hey, welcome back, Maino and the Mayor. Man, how much fun are we having today?
Yeah.
Mark Houston, Bell and Sports Medicine, John Miller, NBC 26, Kevin Burkel, Burkel's one block over, Ashley from the Heights Pub and Parlor, and of course, Jurko. And we got Dennis from the Glam Band who will be performing tonight at the Wharf in Manitowoc, which is an amazing setting. Like I said, when we came to watch you that one night, we sat at the Sub Pub, and it was that beautiful night. And the music just comes across the water, and the sun was going down.
That's
just
awesome.
Amazing setting. I told you about that one guy that was kind of stood by us, and he goes, boy, isn't this place great? I go, yeah. He goes, man, every time I'm on vacation, this is where I come to. I'm like, oh, that's great. I go, where are you from? He goes, South Manitowoc.
Woo! That was his getaway.
Three blocks.
That was his getaway.
Introduce our very special guest here.
We have, on my immediate right, we have Nick Gonnering. How you doing, sir?
Nick. Good, man. How you guys doing?
Fantastic. And who is your special musical guest?
My special friend here is Mr. Brent Felchlin. He's an amazing mandolin player that I play with quite frequently around the area here. So.
Yeah, we're That's listening beautiful. To you guys warm up. I mean, this is fun music. I mean, this is like entertaining, fun music. And we're going to hear some, but tell us a little bit about how you guys got to be together, partners, whatever,
sure.
And where you're playing. I know where you're playing, but you can tell our listeners.
So Brent and I, we've actually known each other for like 15 years or so, something like that.
You guys were pretty young.
Yeah, that's true.
It seems like you still get along.
We met when we were babies. Yeah.
Right. That's cool.
He came out with a mandolin in his hand, and I was just like, that guy.
That's the right size.
Pull him over here. Get him in my band later on. Yeah. No, we've known each other for a long time. I actually used to work for Brent. And now, in a way, he kind of works for me, I guess. But.
Yeah. Well, how the tables have turned.
Yeah.
Let's use the word with.
Yes. With.
Yeah. So, we've been picking bluegrass now, I guess, particularly for the last, like, 3, going on 4 years now. Brent, he's a veteran in this area, but I'm pretty fresh to the scene.
I'm sorry, but I was watching when I was up in Marquette this past weekend.
Yeah.
They had a big bluegrass festival up there. Were you guys part of that?
No, we weren't up there.
Oh.
I know, we're trying to get into all the places around the area, but, you know, it's like Wisconsin goes so hard in the summer, and yeah. everybody's just like full throttle, like, you know.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And how?
Yeah.
Jeez.
Yeah. You're getting like 100 gig requests a week. You're like, okay, all right, let's do this, 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 and this, and then maybe that. And then, you know, you hear about opportunities like
right.
that
you
later get,
you're
on.
Right. But you already made a commitment, and you're, you know, good to your word, right? So you yeah. can't switch to go over. How is bluegrass doing as a genre?
I'd say it's popping off right now.
Yeah.
If that's a proper expression.
No, that's cool. I mean, that's... Right, it's picking up. There's more bluegrass because I think it yeah. was really popular, and I hear more of these festivals and things coming up, and that's awesome. That
I think there's like a different level of bluegrass that's currently being activated too, where it's like a lot of that, like, for some reason, for a while there, it's like the bluegrass like strayed away from that like high lonesome like yodely sound, you know, uh-huh. and now it's like reverting back to that. I guess like 4-part, 5-part harmony is like crazy good singing is like, it's all at that pinnacle stage.
Where I will say this though, bluegrass people, the people that like bluegrass, they love bluegrass.
Oh, yeah.
There's like almost like no in between.
It's like a cult
so
following.
If you're going to do it, and if you're going to try to do old school, you better, it's kind of like Dennis with the glam band. For the people that love that era of music, you can't just put on the whatever, whatever. You better be as professional and as, you know, talented as possible, or they yeah. won't buy it.
Yeah, yeah, you put that makeup on. Go ahead.
Right, we're going to change this up a little bit. They don't like that. They want to hear, like you said, true bluegrass.
Now here's something for our new album.
And that's great, though, too, because, you know, bluegrass, you know, you want to call it hardcore bluegrass or original bluegrass or genuine bluegrass, whatever, however you want to call it. It's such a unique sound, unique mm-hmm. style, you know, from the mountains, you know, of, you know, the Appalachia, whatever, and what have you. But there was a long stretch there in the last, I guess, generation or so where there's, I guess, a hybrid, as you were talking about
yeah.
before. And that really intrigued the heck out of me because I like mashups. I like different types of yeah. music thrown together and whatnot. And there's some of my favorite music is bluegrass and some hybrid stuff from in the last couple decades or whatever, like Leftover Salmon, for example, mm-hmm. is one of my favorite bands, and I just enjoy the living Bee Gees out of them. There's this dude's playing the mandolin, and he's got pedal, you know, guitar pedals on the floor of the stage, and it just sounded like Eddie Van Halen playing the mandolin. I'm going, mm-hmm. what's going on? And it's just, you know, it's stuff like that. It just, you have to open up your mind and just enjoy music for what it is, and it's just a pleasurable experience.
Cool.
So that's why I awesome. Like bluegrass, because it opens up your mind if you let it.
Let's hear something, you guys.
Sure.
Hey, I just got to ask, one of my favorite songs is Rocky Top. Is that bluegrass?
Technically. Well, I mean, it's like,
okay.
That's like that early country
that was a little,
getting into bluegrass.
It was blurred.
Is yeah. that the University of Tennessee's fight song?
Right, exactly. Yes.
Good yep, old yep. Rocky Top.
That's right.
Got a text here. Bluegrass Rocky rules. Tennessee. I was a rock guy for 40 years. Now I'm into bluegrass sound. Blue Ox Festival.
Yes.
There you go.
Blue All Ox right. is huge around the area. That's, yeah, another one of those cult following kind of spots. And they're really bringing in, like, the best of, like, the Wisconsin and the Midwest area. Especially.
That's awesome.
And beyond, too. I mean, I think Leftover Salmon was there recently, weren't they?
They would have to yeah. have been. They would have to have been, yeah. Yeah.
Billy
we got 1 minute for this break. You want to wait till the break's over and then okay. she can go longer?
Let's play into the break.
What?
Amanda
says, nope, keep going.
She's like, great. Right.
We're going to push right. through.
no. That's one of those classic ones you got to know. Should we just do a little hot sauce for him?
There you go. Hot sauce.
Nice.
Love it.
This is a tune we wrote called Hot Sauce. It's actually on our, we have a new album that we're releasing. We'll talk a little bit more after the break
right.
here. But 1, 2, 3, set.
That's good music.
Dennis, what did we just experience?
That
I always say, watching music create up close and personal like this gives me goosebumps.
Yeah, that.
Wow.
Everybody, like, was stamping their foot.
Yeah, he's not everybody. Yeah. Yeah. Just, didn't even realize I'm going like this with my leg up and down. Just,
he was.
Yeah. That's good. That means we're doing our job right.
Yeah.
Well, he wasn't within the beat, but he was just doing it today.
Like, cool. I was going to
stand up and do a jig, but I was running out of room.
Here's my Billy Strings.
You can't tap on the two. That's the only stipulation. They can't be like clapping on the two like that, you know?
That's blues, man.
That is fun music.
That's some old churchy stuff right there. Yeah.
I bet you get the crowd into it. That is fun music.
Do. Well, and there's a lot of different elements to bluegrass. Like, there's that like burner style like that. That's hot sauce. It's like the hot one that we pick, you know? But then you've got like all these old lonesome like... You know,
I'm
those
sad.
Old like waltzy song kind
of. Yeah. I'm so jealous of people that can play an instrument.
I know,
like this.
It's just like,
and
that.
They make it look so easy.
Well, he's got the hands of a guitar player.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's
for those totally watching along on Facebook. Look
at
that.
I
mean, look at me. I got the size of a carny. You know, like smell like cabbage.
You got it though. You can rock that.
Hard no. Look at that.
Those are strong. They got the meat back here.
Well, that's a bone spur. Broke this in four places.
Yeah, that's
why
actually
I can't
that's a ganglion.
That's what gets pushed off the bleachers.
This is straight up. This is me. So yeah. So that's why.
Dennis, I'm going to chime in right here. Okay, you have longer fingers than I do. I have short, tiny hands.
We've done this
and
before,
I've been
girlfriend.
A violist for over 20 years.
See?
So if I can do it, you can do it.
You can make it work. Wow. She's playing viola, too. That's
tough. Hey, speaking of work, you guys worked hard for that song.
That's true, yeah.
I mean, that's a lot of energy you're putting in there.
That's one, we use this term wood shopping. Which is like getting out to the wood shop and like working on stuff. And hot sauce has been one we've been cutting on for a long time.
Pretty good chemistry between you two guys too.
No, we hate each other.
Yeah, that's it.
I mean, watching, like, yeah.
For those watching along on Facebook Live, it was great too because you could see the communication between the eyes.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
The eyes when it came down to the stops, dun 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 stuff.
Man,
you know, and
we even messed that one up. I forgot to throw in the main melody again at the end, and then I looked at Rev Brent, and he's like, "Okay, we'll do it."
He followed you on that.
It looked like a little freestyling. That was awesome.
Yeah. We our listeners, we always like to ask, and we're gonna go to break pretty soon, but. You're starting this mentor, it was teacher, dad, uncle, or it was Earl, I don't know who the big...
Where did it all come from? Is that what you're saying?
what are you asking me? Who's your dad?
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, let us know. Let's start with that.
So I guess for me, I really got into picking bluegrass after Billy Strings came into my life, really. Yeah, same as a lot of people are saying probably. He really... like bridge the gap between that old timey stuff and like the new like jam grass stuff that we kind of pick into and I really like. But Brent's been trying to turn me on to bluegrass for a long time. So you've got a way deeper background with this. You want to give him a little shot on that?
So you have a deeper background?
Yeah, he does.
That's right.
Much deeper.
Yeah, I've been picking in the bluegrass scene for many years, played in a few different bluegrass bands that were like straight up bluegrass before this. But I love what Nick brings to the table just as far as like the soul of it all. And when we play, it's like very in the moment, you know, kind of like you witnessed there of just, you know, we're connected.
But
I just saw Jim and I both sitting right here and you two saw the same thing. Wow. Were you guys communicating with your eyes?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, we're undressing each other.
But I want to get back to you.
From the chin
Jim
up.
Does that to me almost every day.
From the chin up, it's amazing. That's what a gentleman does right there.
Before I weigh in so I can throw up. Yeah. Tell me a little bit. I want to get back to a teacher. Did you do this in church? Or I want to get this start for younger kids.
Just in terms of like where you can learn bluegrass. Is that what
No. I want to know where you got the desire to... pick up a guitar.
Even bluegrass, just in general.
Right. Way back. let's see.
Not that old.
I think I was like 12 when I first got a guitar. Honestly, my uncle played guitar, and I always thought it was really cool that he could do that stuff. But... and he'd just sing me some song all of a sudden, and I'd be like, oh, man, that's cool. And then he let me borrow his guitar when I was younger, and then I got a guitar for my birthday, and then I started playing in rock bands. I used to play in a rock band around the area.
That's very cool.
Yeah.
I mean, 12 years old, you liked your uncle, your parents believed in it and got you one for your birthday.
Yeah,
yeah, that's very cool. How's your start?
Honestly, exactly the same. It was my uncle, Steve Austin. he was a bluegrass picker, kind of in the form of John Hartford.
Ooh.
And he would play on my grandma's porch, and I remember he put a guitar in my hands, taught me a hammer-on, and the rest is history.
Legend. That's John Hartford. Wow.
You guys had a quick break. John Hartford. It's knowing that your door is always open and your path is free to walk.
Look at this. This right? guy knows, this guy knows his yep. stuff.
Never heard it.
Yeah. Can you play a little of that on the way out?
Yeah. We got to send it to a quick break. More from a couple of very entertaining and talented gentlemen, Nick and Brent, the Garnering Music. Back after this.
You're on air. You're on air. You're on air.
Call. That's awesome. Man, fun stuff.
Dennis, wow. we're Jim and I are just musical fans. For you, that's somebody, a musical professional, give me your two cents.
Smooth as glass is what that is.
Oh, yeah.
Dang. Yeah, that's what that is. Honest to Pete, my guys. I mean, how do you bring that on a Friday morning yet, you know? The smooth, your voice is just amazing.
Finger, yeah. I was watching his fingers go up. And, that's pretty amazing, wasn't it?
You know, you have the right voice for that kind of music, you know? I mean, Dennis will probably tell you more about that, but that is good music. That is fun music. I'm going to definitely see you Monday at Copper State.
Yeah,
you know?
Can't wait to see that.
Where else are you playing, and how do we follow you?
So you can check out, honestly, I have been trying to steer away from posting everything on Facebook, but I did just post a graphic of all the shows that are coming up on Nick Honoring Music.
Was it graphic?
Yeah. Okay. It was very graphic. Yeah. Good.
No wonder.
That's like a picture of me like screaming into a microphone. spit coming out.
Great.
But the best place to check it out is the website, nickhonoringmusic.com. And you can see the whole show schedule. We'll be at Ledgestone Vineyards tomorrow.
Such a fun place, isn't it?
I love that spot.
Me too.
That's like a 5 to 7:30, like right when the sun's going down.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Just beautiful out there. So we'll be picking some bluegrass. More trad tunes for that one tomorrow. Like trad bluegrass stuff, old school, you know, Black Mountain.
Traditional to the layperson.
Yes. Trad.
I got to ask you, who did you guys listen to growing up?
You know, I listened to a lot of rock and roll growing up in this area, to be honest with you. And then my wife and I lived down in North Carolina for 5 years. And I got bit by the bluegrass bug when we came back, actually. I hated bluegrass when we were down there for some reason.
Wow.
Yeah. And then when I came back here, I just like loved that mountain sound.
I said, that's almost the birthplace of it, isn't it?
Yeah.
Pretty close. Yeah.
Yeah. Asheville, North Carolina.
Yeah. Yeah.
Brent, how about yourself?
You know, I grew up listening to all genres of music and came around to bluegrass through the Grateful Dead. In college, I was listening to Jerry Garcia and learned that he did some stuff with David Grisman.
You know, Jim just told me that he listened to, who was it? What's their, from the Pink Floyd, a bunch in college. And I think he may have been at the time.
I got a feeling you may have been doing the same, Brent, or am I wrong?
Yeah. We might have been in the same circle.
Yeah. I remember you. I knew when you walked in, you looked familiar.
Dude, I know you.
I know you.
You got my roach clip, man.
Dennis, give everybody a plug for what's going on with everybody here.
Well, jeepers, I mean, I was looking at your schedule, and you got some really neat places that you play.
Yeah.
I mean, and I guess from that standpoint, what's the near future looking like for you guys?
We got a lot of shows coming up. We have like 10 shows this month, actually, coming
up. That's great.
So like I said, check the schedule for
you play some cool places.
Oh,
so,
yeah.
I, by the way, I'm a follower now. I found, you know, trying to find out where you're playing and whatnot. Tell us more about some of the places that you're playing, because they're really cool. We got 1 minute before we got to wrap it up, but...
Like I said, Ledgestone tomorrow is going to be sweet. It's a nice vineyard vibe.
Yeah.
Monday, we're doing the Bluegrass Burner. So this is actually every second Monday of the month. Going into the winter, it'll be the warmer. We get a bluegrass band together. There's an upright bass player, a fiddle player. Sometimes there's a banjo guy. Brent on mandolin and myself, and we do a bunch of old bluegrass stuff. So come out for that on Monday. And then next Thursday, we're actually supporting Armchair Boogie at Gather on Broadway.
Oh, cool.
Gather's great.
Yeah, it's going to be a great spot. So those are great shows to check out.
You guys are phenomenal. Yeah. Wonderful having you here.
Thank you.
Dennis Glam Band, I'm surprised you're playing tonight. You're going to miss the Packers game.
We're playing during the game.
During the game.
Scheduled before the schedule came out.
Oh, a lot of people are going to miss the game.
Yeah.
Because they're going to be with you, Dennis.
Glam Band, tonight at the Wharf in Manitowoc. We're out of time. You guys are awesome. Thank you all so very much for being here.
Thank you so much, guys.
Appreciate you.